So today I would like to tell you about my PhD, which is about the beginning and the end. And what I try to do is to answer big philosophical questions such as, where does it all come from? Where are we going? Are we alone in the universe? And what is good and what is evil? But I wanted to answer them in a cosmological perspective. And since the cosmological scales are so big, I first want to show you some cosmological timescales, starting from the about 100 years, the life of Charles Darwin, and we will go to cosmological scales. So first we go to the scale of human history, so about 5,000 years. Then to the scale of hominids, the genre of humans. Then to the scale of the whole life, so about 4 billion years. Now to the scale of the Earth, 4.5 billion years. And the scale of the cosmos, 13 billion years. So if we go back to humanity right now, we see that we are just a very, very small point in this time frame, the time frame of cosmic evolution. But we are also small in terms of scales, as this movie from the power, which is called The Powers of Ten, which was released in 1977. So it starts from the cosmological scale at 10 to 24 meters, and we will now zoom in until our galaxy. Then we'll approach a common star, our sun, and go further and further. So the solar system, the outer solar system, the inner solar system, the orbit of the Earth. Now we see the Earth and the moon here, the Earth, and we jump by powers of 10 every second. So the point here is that we are very small in terms of scale also. And to continue the journey, because we are not even halfway now, I will show you another movie, because the other one wasn't actually accurate. So here we went from the cosmological scale to the human scale, which is here. So we are not even halfway to the minimum scale. So let's continue to the minimum scale that physics that we know from current physics. So here we have the scale of insects, of cells, of the DNA, atoms with the electrons, then the atomic nuclei, the quarks. And now it gets interesting. And you see why? Because there is emptiness. We don't know anything about this scale. We don't know any particles, any things which could happen. So to me it means that there is an immense gap in our knowledge that we still have to explore those inner scales. But, so, in this view, we are very small in the whole scheme of cosmic evolution. But the story of cosmic evolution is also one of increasing complexity. And we know the story of the increase of complexity from galaxies, stars, planets, to plants, animals, brains, to our information society. So there is also this trend of complexity growth. So the outline of my talk will follow my PhD. First, I will say about worldviews. Then I will speak about the origin of the universe and our future in the universe. So, of course, the question, if we want to tackle such big questions, is where to start from. And I chose to start from a philosophical point of view, inspired by the philosopher Leo Apostel, who wanted to construct comprehensive and coherent worldviews, integrated worldviews. Then I proposed the criteria to compare different worldviews, and then I applied the criteria to different religious, scientific, or philosophical worldviews. But now to tackle the difficult questions, we need to mix philosophy with science, with scientific insights. And so I relied in my speculation, in my discussion, on the most general theories that I, let's say, trust, which are logic, theoretical computer science, thermodynamics, relativity theories, system theory, and evolutionary theories. So it's a very ambitious endeavor, but the conclusions should be taken with a grain of salt, because it's philosophical rather than scientific enterprise, and I consider alternative speculation generally, and also I made very clear what my speculation hinged by drawing argumentative maps that I will be able to show you after. So if we ask the question about the origin of the universe, we know more or less to describe the cosmic evolution, but the big problems arise at the Big Bang era, because our knowledge becomes very uncertain, and I distinguished 7 different challenges at the origin of the universe, which are epistemological, metaphysical, thermodynamical, causal, related to infinities, to free parameters, and to fine-tuning. I also did a more cognitive analysis of these problems, and I asked the question, what are our cognitive expectations for a satisfying explanation of the origin of the universe? And I concluded that our explanations tend to fall into 2 kinds, either the point explanation or either the cycle. The point explanation includes explanations like the Big Bang or a God, which starts everything with a point, or cycles like the cyclic universes. But I also opened the way to that in principle other explanations could be valid as well, but they are harder to imagine for our brain. So then I focused on two issues, which are the free parameter issue and the fine-tuning issue. The free parameter issue says that there are 3 parameters in the standard model of particle physics and in cosmological models, which in principle can be filled in with any number. And the fine-tuning problem says that those 3 parameters are further fine-tuned for the emergence of life, intelligence, or complexity. And my conclusion is that this fine-tuning remains a conjecture, in the sense that we don't have any proof yet, but it's likely to be true from various arguments, lines of arguments. But to reassess if it's true or not, I argued that we should simulate other possible universes to see if our universe is somehow special or not, and I call this endeavor artificial cosmogenesis. So then I review the fine-tuning explanation, the classical ones here, but also evolutionary explanations on which I focused on, which are cosmological natural selection and cosmological artificial selection. And this brings us to the third part of my PhD, our future in the universe. The fundamental problem about the future of the universe is that there are really two opposite trends. The first is the local increase of complexity, and the second one starts from extrapolating the second law of thermodynamics, which says that disorder in the system can only increase, and if we apply this to the universe, then globally we are doomed to disappear. So the question is, which trend will dominate in the long term, the increase in order or the increase in disorder? So to go back to natural and artificial selection, natural selection explains much of the complexity in the biological realm. So it's actually a good idea to try to explain the complexity of our own universe with the same tools as biology. But artificial selection is also another form of selection, which sometimes can go faster than natural selection, such as when humans did breed dogs, they were able to create a huge variety of dogs in much less generations than natural selection. So with artificial selection, we have the power to to direct biological evolution. So the question is, does it apply, could it apply to the universe? And I developed the scenario of cosmological artificial selection, which is an extension of cosmological natural selection, and actually a speculative philosophical scenario to make sense of different problems: the origin of the universe, the fine-tuning, the future of the universe, a cosmic doom, and a possible role for intelligent life, which would play a role in a cosmic replication cycle. So, cosmological artificial selection is a future stage at which intelligent life worries about the cosmic doom, is able to conceive and make new universes. The degree of this is to remains to debate. And it's actually a solution to a cosmic doom, because it's similar to the solution of biology, to the solution of aging in biology, which is to make children, basically, to make offspring. And we may say that it's the last evolutionary replication threshold, where the universe itself reproduces. So, if we look at our cosmological worldviews, and in our scientific progress, we are more or less halfway. We have refuted three dogma of centrism, which are geocentrism, the idea that the Earth is the center of the universe; heliocentrism, the idea that our Sun is at the center of the universe; and galactocentrism, the idea that our galaxy would be somehow special at the center of the universe. But there are still three centrisms to refute, if we follow this logic, which is biocentrism, that the idea that life on Earth is unique in the universe; intellicentrism, the idea that intelligent life is unique on Earth; and universe-centrism, the idea that our universe is unique. So I would like to quickly ask you a question. Actually, this question here: are we alone in the universe? Who thinks we are alone in the universe?
I don't know.
Okay. Who thinks there is life, but it's probably bacterial life or very primitive life? Yeah. And who thinks there is a more advanced life? Oh, interesting. Maybe it's because I communicated. So, yeah, the bottom line is that if we are alone, if we want to check this, we need to still explore the cosmos to be sure that we are alone. So we need to still to search for extraterrestrial. If there is only less advanced, then I would say yes, it has a good chance to succeed, and there is a lot of work presently in astrobiology to find exoplanets, and it's a field which is progressing very fast. So it might we might leave this discovery in our lifetime. And and for those, most of you who replied that life might be more advanced, I would agree, because there are arguments which show that if there is life elsewhere, on average, it's 2 billion years older than us. So I focused on searching extraterrestrials more advanced than us for this reason and other reasons. And how do we find advanced extraterrestrials? I extrapolated two civilizational developmental trends. The one is the energy use, that we use more and more energy. I use the Kardashev scale, which says that civilization starts to master the energy of a planet, then the energy output of a star, and then of a galaxy. And the Barrow scale of manipulating smaller and smaller entities. So the Kardashev scale, here on the x-axis you have time, and on the y-axis you have the energy use. So humanity is more or less in the middle of this energetic phase transition. We are using more and more energy of the planet, and the only limit is really using the whole output of the star, of our Sun. And the Barrow scale development is the idea that you saw in the movie previously, that there are more there is more to explore in small scales than in large scales. So there is a huge potential to organize space in the very small. And so if we combine those two ideas using the energy of a star plus having technology or organized on very, very small scale, we come to the idea of a very dense object which uses the energy of a star. And this is not science fiction. This is an artist illustration of what's called a binary system, which accretes some matter, which sucks in some matter of a companion star, which rotates here and which is processed here at the center of the dense object, which can be a white dwarf, a neutron star, or black hole. And here, by comparison, you see the Earth, which is on scale compared to the Sun. So, of course, it's very speculative, it's very hard to test, and maybe we are more like a plant trying to understand the life of carnivores, and that's why I've called those putative extraterrestrials starivores, because they eat stars, so I call them starivores by association with carnivores. And so since it's very difficult to find what it is, I set up a prize, which is the High Energy Astrobiology Prize. And there is 500 euros to win if in any of these scientific projects. So the last chapter of my PhD is about cosmological ethics and immortality. And I concluded that from a cosmological or evolutionary perspective, what matters is the survival of larger and larger cooperative systems, which use more and more efficiently free energy which is available. I also discussed the idea of immortality, which is a fundamental longing in humans. And especially, I made the case for cosmological immortality, which arises when we have a compassion for the whole of cosmic evolution, when we refuse to let the universe die, and therefore decide that the ultimate good is the infinite continuation of the evolutionary process. So to conclude, to answer the question I thought at the beginning, tentatively answer, I tackled the two questions: where does it all come from, and where are we going actually together with the scenario of cosmological artificial selection? Regarding the question if we are alone in the universe, I would say maybe not, but we should still keep an eye on starivores and assess this idea. And regarding what is good and what is evil, the ultimate conclusion is that the ultimate good is the infinite continuation of the evolutionary process. My second conclusion comes from a remark of the philosopher William James, who said that philosophical activity gives birth to new scientific disciplines. And with insights, I propose to give birth to two new scientific disciplines. The first is artificial cosmogenesis, that is a scientific study of possible universes. And the second one, high energy astrobiology, which is a subset of astrobiology to test the existence of life forms in high energy phenomena, and in particular in binary systems. Thank you for your attention.